Well, welcome to the planning board meeting of, what day is it? July 10th, 2023, 6:30 PM. And Andrea will read our prelude.
This meeting will be held in a hybrid fashion with the opportunity for both in-person attendance and remote participation in accordance with House Bill Number 58 of the 193rd General Court, which extended the governor's March 12th, 2020 order suspending certain provisions of the open meeting law, Mass General Law, Chapter 30A, Section 20, until March 31st, 2025. Please note that while an option for remote attendance and or participation is being provided as a courtesy to the public, the meeting hearing will not be suspended or terminated if technological problems interrupt the virtual broadcast unless otherwise required by law. Members of the public with particular interest in any specific item on this agenda should make plans for in-person versus virtual attendance accordingly. For purposes of in-person attendance, the town of Deerfield will host the meeting in the main meeting room of the Deerfield Municipal Offices with remote participation details noted below. Then there's a Zoom link and meeting ID, et cetera. Meeting attendees should mute phones, *6 for landlines, unless asking questions or commenting. All attendees should wait to speak until other participants are finished.
All right. Thank you, Andrea. All right. Just wanted to let everyone know guidelines for a business meeting. Please speak one at a time, follow Deerfield Code of Conduct, be respectful, considerate, courteous, concise, and recognized by the chair. Okay, going to identify board members in attendance. Kathy Witroba.
Yes. Kathy Witroba here.
Andrea Liebson.
Andrea Liebson here.
Annalee Wolfcole.
Annalee Wolfcole here.
Kathy Sylvester.
Kathy Sylvester here.
Rachel Blaine.
Here, Rachel Blaine.
And Emily Gaylord.
Emily Gaylord here.
Great, thanks. Got a full attendance. All right, next on the agenda, review minutes. I know we did receive. I'm sorry, what? Okay. All right.
Okay. I have a question about the date on the minutes. Mm-hmm. It says Monday, 6th of February. Is that accurate?
Yeah, I think that's a typo.
Typo, right. Yeah. It should be.
Right. May 3rd.
April 3rd.
Okay. You can change that. Are there any additions or corrections to those minutes?
I move we approve the minutes of April 8th.
April 3rd. Do I hear a second?
I second, Kathy Sylvester.
All right. Any discussion? No. Okay. Minutes have been accepted for April 3rd, 2023. We still have some outstanding minutes that hopefully we can get them by next time.
There's another one that's not even on.
One of them is missing. That's a 627. I've been working on those.
Too. Okay, 627. Well, we'll continue working on those.
We both.
All right, great. Thank you. All right, under old business, let's see. I'm changing this up a little bit. We had Old Frontier first, but I'd like to put the condominiums at Sugarloaf first. And I think Mr. Whiteman, if you want to come up. Anybody? And sign in, please. Okay.
To tell the truth.
Yes. And when you speak, can you make sure that you speak closely to the microphone so everyone can hear? Okay. Thanks.
Hello, folks. I think we all know each other. My name is Mark Whiteman. I was a developer of the condos of Sugarloaf. I am no longer affiliated whatsoever. Very happy man.
I bet.
This is Mark. He's the president of the Condominium Association. This is Wendy. She's on the board as well. They've asked me to make a appearance to discuss with you folks the taking over the roads, bringing it onto the town warrant to have the roads taken over by the town. That was the intention from the very beginning, of course. The process is as follows, which you probably are aware of. One resident of Deerfield has to submit a letter to the select board asking for the road, a road or roads, to be taken over by the town. When that occurs, there's a select board meeting that happens because of that. And the select board discusses the issue. and decides whether they're going to back it and endorse it to be brought to the planning board, so the planning board can review the requirements to be able to have the roads approved. If that occurs and the planning board says yes, then it goes back to the select board and they have a public hearing so that people can speak their minds regarding this. And if it goes past that, then it gets put on the town warrant. It has to be done 7 days prior to the town warrant to actually be able to be on the town warrant.
Right.
The select board unanimously agreed to send this to the planning board very quickly. They understand, they've been through the process with us as well. The planning board, of course, this is sort of a redundant process because the planning board has already approved the plans saying that the road was built to town specifications through the permits. I think the reason we're back and the reason it goes this direction typically is that anybody in town living on any county road, let's say, could solicit the town to be able to take that road over. And then the town would say, select board would say, yes, we don't see a problem with investigating that, but you'll have to go to the planning board to find out what you have to do to bring it up to town specifications. Mm-hmm. And then the planning board would lay out the specifications of width and grade and materials and things of that fashion. We've already done all that. And again, I think it's a redundant process that has to happen because of the protocol, but it's already been done by the board. We find it difficult that you guys could not approve it because it's already been approved by you. It's certainly, more stranger things have happened, but it has been already approved by the board. Nothing's changed. So we're here seeking that endorsement tonight, and then it'll go back to the plan or to the select board so they can have their public hearing.
Great. Thanks. Well, thanks for explaining that. So I don't have to, because I was trying to explain the whole process. So
no charge.
Is everyone clear with that process?
Yeah.
Natalie?
Yes. I just have a question. I understand, that we certainly have looked at the road and found that the road is amenable to being designed as or being built as planned, but I'm not so sure about our role in actually opining whether or not it should be a public or private way.
So the question is not to you folks, is not whether you think it should be a public way or not. The question to you is, does it meet the requirements of a public way? Mm. And that's what you have signed off on. And Annalie, I want to make sure that we're doing this correctly and your attorney's not here. I'm not sure that that you could be involved in the conversation because it's still about the condominiums and the butter.
That's right.
Yeah, you're supposed to refuse and not even be in the room, actually.
Okay.
So I'm happy to answer the question, but I want to make sure we're not breaking any rules so that we can go forward with this. Okay. So that's what you're actually looking at tonight is saying whether or not it meets the requirements of a town road or what requirements have to be met to make it a town road. We already know it does.
Which
that.
It has.
Yeah.
So that was a good question, Annalie, that you weren't supposed to ask, but that's okay. And that was a good answer. Thank you.
And may I ask a question? So
yes.
it's not up to us to say, yes, it's going to be a town way or not. Now we are just saying whether or not we believe it could go forward to town meeting.
Public hearing to the selectmen. Yes,
it goes to the select board first, then a public hearing, then it goes to town meeting, hopefully in the fall. So
yes, we heard maybe October, mid-October.
Yeah, the October. Yeah. I mean, I believe we have a meeting.
Yes.
Then, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, and this is basically a procedural issue. It's really nothing more than that.
Right.
So I know that I listened to a little bit to the select board meeting. I know that I forget how you pronounce his last name. Tony Wislecki?
Wanseski.
Okay. Yeah. He was here and did a good job explaining things. So
he does a wonderful job. Yeah. Dragged him out of retirement.
Yeah. I know. Well, he'll never be retired. But anyway, thank you. Does anybody else have any other questions? Knowing that it's basically procedural?
No, it's basically procedural. No.
Yeah.
Rachel, you're good? Emily, questions? No? All right. Do I hear a motion to vote this to go back to the select board so they can have a public hearing?
I motion that we send this back to the select board to have a public hearing on the endorsement for the roads at Sugarloaf Condominium to be qualified as a public road.
Is a town accepted road.
Yeah. Is a town accepted road.
I second Rachel Blaine. And I don't know if we endorse, do we approve? I'm not sure what the word is here.
Yeah, the what Chris wrote was a report. I would say you would vote to endorse it. Oh, I'm sorry. I think maybe you should vote to endorse it, going back to the endorse the roads as meeting requirements.
Right.
Okay. Okay. Would you like to amend your motion?
Sure. I thought that's what I said, but I will say it again. I motion that we endorse the roads of Sugarloaf Condominium, that they meet their requirement, and we send it back to the select board for their approval.
Yeah.
Public hearing.
For the public hearing.
They've already.
And I still second it, Rachel Blaine.
Okay. Is there any discussion? No? All right. I guess you're all set, Mr. Whiteman.
We have to vote.
Oh, gosh. I'm sorry, I forgot. Okay, Kathy Latroba.
Kathy Latroba, yes.
Andrea Leibson.
Andrea Leibson, yes.
Annalee Wolfcool.
Annalee Wolfcool abstain.
Okay. Kathy Sylvester.
Kathy Sylvester, yes.
Rachel Blaine.
Rachel Blaine, yes.
Emily Gaylord.
Emily Gaylord, yes.
Denise Mason, yes. So we have six yes and one abstention.
Wonderful.
And now we're all set.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much for coming. All right, and good luck.
We'll see you at town meeting.
Okay. All right. Okay. So we're going to go back to, we're going to go back to some old business, just a few little housekeeping things. Old Frontier Nexamp Solar. That is, here it is. Okay. We have a couple of questions for them, which is different than the other Nexamp issue this evening. And we did hear from the fire chief that we had questions. I guess a lock was approved by the fire department to access. That was approved for purchase, but to the fire chief's knowledge, it has not been installed on the property. So I'll continue to look as to why that hasn't happened. As for the training, something else that they hadn't done, they were pointed to an online training from the NFPA, and there's been no specific site training provided. So once again, I'll continue to see what's going on with that. All right, so the next, we've got planner on the agenda. To my knowledge, the planner economic development person that was okayed by the personnel committee, and it's my understanding that, I mean, that was after second draft, no. Okay, after, I think that was redrafted. And it's my understanding that it will be posted if it hasn't already. So we'll keep you updated on that. And let's see, the third is chapter 179 review update, and that's the planning board bylaws. We already had one meeting with Peggy Sloan from the FERCOG. Two meetings. Okay. And we have a third one slated for July 17th, and we're on our second draft, and she's just been a great asset to the planning board. So we'll continue to work on that. All right.
I would, and we just received the second draft, so we can all review it. Mm-hmm. In advance.
Yeah. So we did receive a second draft. So if everyone can please, you know, look over that and, have any questions ready for the, and that's at 6 p.m., but I'll send out a reminder on that. Okay. So then let's see. The next one is our first public hearing. Okay, and that is for notice is hereby given that Deerfield Planning Board will hold a public hearing on Monday, July 10th, 2023 at 6:30 p.m. on an application filed Peter Barley, Chidsey, for a special permit for property located on 567 River Road, Assessor's Map 66, Lot 2.2, to construct a driveway in excess of 500 feet in length pursuant to zoning bylaws, Chapter 179, 3400. Application documents available for review at municipal offices or online at www.deerfield.mass, the event calendar. All right, just as a reminder, and do we have people here for that online? We do. All right. Mr.
Hello, everybody.
Hi. Hi. I just want to talk about what the process is of this. So if you can talk about, well, first of all, I want to tell you that we did have, I think, a response from, okay, we had a response from
the building commissioner and
yes, and the fire chief, saying that they had no issues. But if you can just describe what you would like to do, and if we have any public comment, they would have 2 to 3 minutes to ask questions, and then it'll go back to the board and we will deliberate. Although I don't see this, and oh, good, our building inspector is here too. Great. Okay. So, Mr. Barley, would you like to tell us about your project?
Hi, everyone. Good evening. Thank you. Yes, so I would like to hire John Colcock to build a driveway onto the property. I'd like to him to do a really nice job. My intention is to create a beautiful little farm there. And by building the longer driveway, I'm going to be avoiding the really good farmland that's the about 100 feet deep Hadley loam on the property. And so the driveway is going to go back into the woods. I'd like to clear around, you know, make it completely fire safe. And the fire department walked it and approved it. And yeah, that should be all.
Okay, thank you. And I know, Mr. Walden, if you want to comment, I know that you said you didn't have, you left, you don't have any issues. And I think that, let's see, who's this from? This is from Mr. Scarborough. He said the first 10 feet of the driveway must be paved. And that's the only instruction that I received. Mr. Waldron? Walden? Bob? I think he's got spotty service where he is.
Yeah, I got terrible service. Okay. Yeah, I have no issues with the driveway. The fire chief walked it with Mr. Cocott, and they came up with, well, a couple different versions depending on how it plays out. But I have no issues with it. And just other than Kevin, the highway superintendent, is requesting that the first 10 feet be paved.
Right. Okay.
All right.
Yeah.
May I ask a question?
Yeah.
I'm just wondering why the first 10 feet need to be paved?
Well, I'll comment on that. I believe it's just to solve any problem of gravel washing down to the road, which happened on some of those steeper driveways on River Road. I think it's easier for them to clean up, and you can pull a vehicle off the road. A little simpler, and then the snow and whatnot. I think it's more of a maintenance issue.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Is there anybody here for public comment on this hearing for this road? No. Okay. Well, I guess we'll take it to the board then. Do we have any additional questions? Anybody? No. It looks pretty straightforward. It looks okay. I don't see any issues with this. I mean, I don't think the fire chief has access to that. I don't think there are any issues. I think just paving the first 10 feet, which I think is really great, because there is a house on our road that has a steep edge. The gravel keeps washing down into the road. So I can understand why you're doing that. Okay. All right. So do I hear a motion to
endorse,
accept the road
through the special
permit? I make a motion to approve 567 River Road special permit.
And do I hear a second?
I second. This is Andrea.
All right. Is there any further discussion?
So for a driveway in excess of 500 feet in length.
Oh. Do I have to say that again?
That's what the special permits.
Do I need to say it over? Okay.
I make a motion that we approve the driveway at 567 River Road in excess of 500 feet. Oh, we endorse. Never mind. Except we approve. Okay.
Are we done? All right. All in favor? Kathy Witroba?
Kathy Witroba, yes.
Andrea Leibson?
Andrea Leibson, yes.
Annalee Wolfcole?
Annalee Wolfcole, yes.
Kathy Sylvester?
Kathy Sylvester, yes.
Rachel Blaine?
Rachel Blaine, yes.
And Emily Gaylord?
Emily Gaylord, yes.
Okay, and Denise Mason, yes. So I think you're good to go. Good luck with your project.
Yeah.
And what's your crop?
Thank you.
And thank you for saving good farmland soil.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm going to have a good 100-foot row of blueberries, 100-foot row of raspberries. Nice. We'll do garlic. We'll do broccoli. It'll depend on the year and the season.
Great.
And I will get the beginning of the driveway paved like they asked, but it's actually has a good 150 feet of flat that comes off the, actually dips down a little bit, goes flat for about 100 feet, and then goes up from there. So it's not steep, just saying that in the beginning of the driveway, it's a nice pull off, but I will get that paved.
All right, well, we wish you all the best.
Thank you, we'll be seeing you around.
Okay, sounds good. All right. Okay, that's going pretty quickly here. So let's see, what else do we have? I think we're all set for next AMP solar. If you'd like to come up to the table, please. And
where's the best place for me to put the board?
Really good question. Easel. Oh, you know what? We can grab. Oh, you have an easel. Oh, perfect. Uh-huh. Yeah, I think so. I mean, the plans are already online. I know it would be difficult for people to see, so I think that's probably all set. As long as the individuals, if you can see that. Okay. I mean, who's gonna say it? Right. Hey, Amy, can you screen share?
I will pull those up and then I will screen share. It's gonna take me a moment.
Okay, that would be great. Thank you.
Okay.
All right. Well, welcome, and I'm going to read the notice of hearing. Notice is hereby given that the Deerfield Planning Board will hold a public hearing on Monday, July 10th, 2023 at 6:30 p.m. on an application filed by Deerfield Renewables, LLC for site plan review for property located at 42 Lee Road, Assessor's Map 110, lots 20 and 21, to construct a 2.9 megawatt solar PV array on the existing Deerfield landfill. Work to include minor regrading, additions to the existing gravel road, battery energy storage system, and infrastructure to support utility interconnection pursuant to zoning bylaws, Chapter 179, 3800, 5300, 5400, and 155. Application documents available for review in foyer of municipal offices or online at www.deerfieldmass.us in the calendar event. Okay. So if you'd like to introduce yourselves, please.
Sure. Well, thank you very much for having us here tonight.
And can you get close to the mic?
And thank you for the town for the last minute push to get us on the agenda for tonight. So we appreciate that. My name is Henry Barrett. I'm with NexAmp, the solar company that is working on this project. And I'm joined by Rob Bukowski from Weston & Sampson, our civil engineering partner. And so what I thought we'd just do is a kind of a quick overview of NexAmp and the project, and then hand it over to Rob to speak to some of the more details of the project. So NextAM, we are headquartered in Boston. We were founded in Massachusetts in 2007 and have been in operation since then with projects all over the state from the Berkshires to Boston and everywhere in between. And you know, we are a long-term owner and operator of all of our projects. A lot of them are structured as community solar projects where local homeowners and small businesses can sign up and get discounts on their utility bills from the energy produced from the arrays. We are proposing this project on the landfill in partnership with the town. Just want to say a note of gratitude to the town for your partnership on this. And I know it's been a long road since this project first started. And so thank you for your patience as we work through some of the issues with Eversource on the interconnection side of things, which is taking a little longer than we anticipated. But we're really excited to be here now at this stage. I think we can finally start to see the light at the end of the tunnel. And so maybe a little bit of sunlight if we ever maybe get sun anymore. Just really excited to finally break ground on this project and get it going. Like I said, you know, we'll be the owner operator of the array. We anticipate it to last up to 40 years. And at which point we'll then decommission the array, remove all the equipment, restore the site to what it was before, and then the town can maybe do another solar project or whatever the town wants at that point. I think with that, I can hand over to Rob, kind of go through some of the details, and happy to take any questions or anything along the way.
All right, thanks, Henry. So again, Rob Bukowski with Weston & Sampson. So as was mentioned, this is a 2.95 megawatt DC solar facility, mainly on the landfill cap. So because of the nature of the landfill, the difference between this and some of the other solar arrays that you may have seen is that nothing can penetrate down through the cap. So in parallel with this, we're going through Mass DEP and the Solid Waste Division to get a post-closure use permit approval, which we anticipate coming probably any day now. We've reached out to them. They haven't had any real comments on the design. We've done a lot of these across the state. So the foundation, so this is a fixed tilt array. You may have seen some of the ones that actually track. This will be fixed. Everything's facing south. The way that the construction will work is the access road will be built, and then gravel will be placed under each concrete foundation block just to level the surface below it. The block will be placed, and then the racking will go up and the modules will go up from there. So, you know, everything's above ground. We did meet with both the fire chief and the DPW super about access. So there's a new road that's proposed on the eastern side of the site. So there's an existing road that goes up onto the landfill cap now. That's gonna be abandoned, at least coming off the transfer station asphalt area. The new road will come up on the eastern side and then end up ultimately tying back into that existing road so that the DPW can still continue to access their areas in the back. But one of the things that the fire chief had brought up was, you know, we need to mark access. We need to make sure that if there ever is an incident out there that the emergency vehicles can get there. So if you look at the sort of top right part there, there's some, I know it's hard to see from this distance, but there's some markings on there that basically say fire lane, no parking. So he just wanted to ensure that if people are out there when the transfer station's open, that there aren't going to be cars parked there that would potentially obstruct any kind of emergency vehicles. The interconnection piece will go again on the eastern side. There'll be some new utility poles proposed for that, and that'll ultimately tie back into the grid on Lee Road. There is a battery energy storage component to this project, which is a requirement of the state incentive program. So that'll be located in that little gap on the east side near the road. They'll be located, that along with the transformer, the inverter, the major electrical equipment will be located on a concrete pad. We did a site walk with DEP last fall.
Yep.
There were a couple areas that they had noted on the landfill that had settled over time, which happens, you know, it's waste below, things, you know, decompose and start to to settle a little bit. So what we've got proposed on the western side is there's a little bit of grading, not cutting into the cap, because again, we can't cut into the cap, but some grading with some fill material to basically create a better pathway for the water to get from the western side of the array down to the southern basin that's next to Lee Road. So as part of the project, excuse me, what we're proposing is some actual drainage improvements for the landfill. You'll see some gaps in the middle. Those are the passive gas vents that are out at the site. Access will be maintained to those so that the town and their consultant can continue to monitor those for gas levels and things like that. We're required by the state to maintain at least a 10-foot radius offset from those vents just for that purpose, so that people can monitor and maintain them. That's pretty much it as far as an overview.
Can you tell me again? This is Rachel Blaine. Can you tell me again where the battery storage? I just missed that. I was going back and forth. Right. Yeah, altogether different. So yeah.
This is the graph.
That's where I thought it was either.
Built time to access the battery storage and then the burger is also.
Got it. Okay. Okay.
This is Annalee Wolf-Cole. Just as a matter of scale, are each one of these little rectangles similar to what we often see in solar arrays, large-scale solar arrays?
As far as the module, the solar panels themselves, or yes, the foundations?
These little squares here.
Yeah, each of those is a panel module, solar module.
Each are easily squares. Yeah. It's like we usually see on.
Yes. Oh, this is in the.
Yeah.
Yeah, you do. It's further in.
Okay. So I have a question as well. I'm curious, the battery storage is increasingly a concern given fire issues, and I'm certain that it's in the right place and that you've got, but can you talk to that a little bit? And then you also are mentioning that you have other sites. So, you know, what have you run into with that in those sites, and how is mitigation sitting on a dump? I don't know if that's good or bad.
Yeah, in that regard. Sure. So we have projects in Massachusetts and New York, and starting to be some other states that have a battery component to it. Mm-hmm. It's usually a solar plus battery like this, and this kind of scale as well. And we haven't run into any issues so far with the operation or maintenance of the projects. You know, this one in particular is a Tesla Megapack system. So it's going to be basically one container size module. And, you know, Tesla, I know there's been stories of, you know, electric bikes exploding and stuff like that. And so part of the reason why we partnered with Tesla, just because of their overall, you know, commitment to quality. The manufacturing is all certified to various UL, you know, OSHA kind of state regulatory authorities. And so, you know, we know where it's being manufactured. We know the manufacturing techniques. They go through very rigorous testing on all of these systems. They have independent engineers test them as well, sort of do like major stress tests on the systems to look at worst case scenarios. And these ones in particular are designed so that if there is any issue, well, first of all, Tesla and Nexamp will be monitoring them 24/7. Mm-hmm. So, and there's triggers and alarms in there. If they go above or below any sort of operating threshold, we'll know instantly and we'll be able to, you know, shut it off remotely. Mm-hmm. If there is any sort of issue, they're designed so that the cells in each are in each module within the container. So they're each in a separate contained, you know, space within the container within a container. And they have a vent at the top and a fan. So it's all meant to go up through the top of the system. If there are any sort of gases or smoke within within the module itself. And so everything will be vented through the top. Tesla recommends that you just kind of let it slowly kind of decompost within the system itself. Don't need to put water on it or anything like that. And then, you know, they can replace it after that. But the idea is just to let it keep it contained, keep it within the container itself, and let it burn out.
Hi, this is Kathy Witroba. Have you experienced anything like that in any of your other projects?
No, we have not.
Okay.
No.
Okay.
May I ask, yes. I'm trying to figure out where the transfer station is in relation to the solar array. So where, you know, people would be coming up regularly.
So it's all within.
Yeah.
That's the
right.
Yeah. Okay.
There's a container right there.
Well, once you got Lee Road.
Yeah.
And then I had another question about what's the height of the battery storage container?
It's about 9 feet high.
And the fence near it is 7 feet
high? 7 feet, yeah.
And what's the exterior material?
Of the fence?
Not the container.
It's just steel. It'd be like painted white steel.
Would it be white? I'm just thinking about how it would be seen by abutters.
Yeah.
Would it be an eyesore? Would it be a reflector? I'm just wondering.
Well, the top of the panels are about 9 feet as well.
Okay.
So you probably won't be able to see the container too much. And it's also, you know, just the elevation, the parking lot is sort of below where the array is going to be. It's sort of up top a little bit. So I don't anticipate there being you being able to see it really.
Go ahead, Kathy. Okay.
So I lived on Lee Road and I lived in the condominiums, and honestly, I didn't even know the dump was there for the longest time. I couldn't figure out there was always hawks. Well, I really didn't know that the dump was even there. It was.
What do you think happened to your trash, Kathy?
I was like, talking about the dump. Where is this dump? I mean, it was right there. So I do have some concerns a little bit for the abutters and the impact. I mean, I think this is great. This is where we need to move to, you know, save ourselves, save our planet. I'm a little, I guess I keep wanting to go back to this battery storage. And the impact of the safety measure in place for abutters in the immediate area, which is close, and how they are protected in the event that there's some meltdown with this battery storage.
Right. So Tesla, in the event of any issue, they basically set aside or designate a 100-foot radius around the container. To sort of, you know, if anything is going on, to keep people away 100 feet from that until it's over. And I think, you know, what's that other project you mentioned earlier, you know, similar to that, we will have, you know, in-person training for the emergency response personnel in town. We spoke with the fire department earlier about it as well and mentioned that to him. So we'll do sort of online and in-person training. I think, you know, it's, if there is any sort of issue there, it's not going to be the way it's designed. It won't turn into a huge conflagration. You know, it'll just be a very localized, even just within a container, within the container event.
I just have one other question, and I'm sorry, but so I'm gonna keep going back to this battery pack only because I don't understand it fully, but it seems to me that is it a relatively new concept for the solar panels to be able to store this energy, right? Like it used to be energy use. Now it's like energy storage use for later on.
Yeah.
So how new is this technology to be using the storage method?
Well, it's so the storage itself is primarily made of lithium ion, which has been used in, you know, cell phone batteries and just sort of regular technology for many years. Yep. I mean, at this scale, it's last 5-10 years maybe. Sort of this kind of larger scale batteries, and it's, you know, as Ron mentioned, it's a state requirement that projects of this size have this type of a battery system with it. Mm-hmm. Which, you know, it's, I think it's a great thing. We need more storage to help our transition to renewable energy. But, you know, it's a relatively new technology with storage, but the underlying technology of the battery has been around for a while.
It's not reinventing a wheel. It's just, right. It's just using it in a different fashion. And so this battery lasts the lifetime of the panels as well.
So the battery has a 15-year warranty, up to 20 years. The panels have like a 25-year warranty.
Okay.
So we probably have to end up replacing the battery before we replaced any panels or other equipment.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. All right. I've got a number of questions.
Page full.
No, so I'm just going to start at the top and I'll share. Okay. So I want to ask all the questions, but you know, I was looking at the fence. First of all, you've got conflicting one place. It says 8 feet, another place it says 7 feet. I don't know whether that's a big deal, but it's nice to have consistency. And you also have it flush to the ground. So, you know, my concern is, I mean, how flush to the ground? My concern is, you know, animals, you know, dogs or something getting through there. And then you've got high voltage. So what happens if something gets through? What happens?
So it's the fence is going to be on concrete block foundations as well. It won't be driven into the ground. Usually what they do is set the block and then the post goes in the block.
Right.
The hole is a little bit bigger than the post in case it needs to be leveled. You can put the post plumb and then grout around the rest of it. And usually when they put the fabric in, they'll cut the fabric. So they'll run it to the ground and then cut the fabric out so it can go up and over these blocks. So, I mean, I've never seen an issue with animals. We do post-construction inspections for a lot of these landfill sites. It's also a requirement from Mass DEP, and we've got some that go back 10 years. And, you know, occasionally we'll see deer, coyote inside the fence. I mean, they're resourceful. They'll find a way. But one other thing that I'll mention is some projects that are in areas like, say, turtle habitat areas, they actually want to have a gap at the bottom to allow wildlife to pass through and go in and out. So I've never seen an issue with pets or anything like
that. What would be the hazard of an animal getting in?
Fried?
No.
No, everything's enclosed.
It's elevated, it's not.
Well, and all the, you know, the electrical wiring and everything, it's all enclosed anyway. Yeah. So,
okay.
You
know. Okay.
We are, yeah.
I mean, you have high voltage signs. Yeah. So what exactly does that mean? High voltage?
Well, all of the main equipment is the inverter, and so that would be an enclosed system where you're not supposed to get in unless you
lock. So if some you know teenager decides, hey, I'm going to go climb the fence and see what's there, they're not going to get fried either.
Right.
They'll just get arrested by the police.
Yeah.
All right. Another one is I guess the big thing, you know, I'm concerned. You know, when you start construction about all this rain, obviously we have climate change, which hopefully everyone will agree that we've had a lot of rain lately. And so the concern is about the runoff. And I mean, has your plan changed at all after all the rainfall that we've received in the past month or so? Do you think that there'll be any issues with that in construction?
I don't. And one of the reasons I'll say is because we do a lot of support for solar development projects, and most of them aren't on landfills that have established vegetation, right? I mean, you can look at some of the greenfield sites where it's maybe farmland or it's forested and everything has to be cleared and regraded and all that stuff. The good thing here is the landfill is well vegetated, it's established. Most of the issues that we see during construction are related to erosion or sedimentation, but since we're not cutting into the vegetation into the landfill cap, everything's going to be placed above it. I don't foresee any issues.
Okay. May I ask a question about that? So the vegetation that's under the panels will stay?
Yes.
Okay. And vegetation on the outside of the fence to perhaps make it a visual buffer for abutters, will there be vegetation on the outside of the fence?
It'll just be similar to what's inside. I mean, we'll end up mowing the site probably once or twice a year, both within the fence and then just a swath right immediately outside the fence just to keep major stuff from growing up over the fence.
But nothing tall would be planted on the outside of the fence to shield it from the...
Right.
Excuse me, Emily. Well, it is hard for me to tell from the abutters map that is included in your application exactly how close the abutters are. I mean, Appendix, which one? Oh, and then, is it on V101? Is that the
Abutters?
The abutters, exactly how close they are. I mean, as I'm looking on Appendix E, which is different from
how close they're.
So I think for the residents to the east, that's further up Lee Road. Henry and I were actually looking at this earlier today. Wasn't it about 400 feet?
Yeah, from the edge of the panel to the garage of the abutter there. It's about 400 feet.
The edge of the panel to the garage. No, I'm sorry.
This point here, closest panel.
I see. Yeah.
The garage is
over
here.
Mm-hmm.
The corner of the garage, the house.
So is that the closest to butter?
Yeah, and then there are residential houses that are here. But they're a good further distance from.
Okay.
So I guess.
If one inch is 50 feet, according to the map, then you're saying that potential, isn't it at the bottom, it's 1 inch is 50 feet?
Yeah.
That we've got probably 600 feet between either the 7 foot fence or the 9 foot screens.
Then all of this would be left, all this vegetation here would be left intact. This is currently what it's treated.
Okay.
It's all the that's
much. Okay, yeah, that was my question. You know, the vegetation that exists, I mean, it's mostly trees. I mean, there's screening to begin with, mm-hmm. all around.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. And the trees are mature trees, so they're taller than 9 feet. It's going to be taller than 9 feet if you're putting it on top of the landfill. You know, from ground level to the top, what would that be, like 20 feet?
Well, it's ground level, just wherever on top of the landfill. So it'll be 9 feet from the ground.
But if you're going ground level from the dump, from the paved part of the dump to the top of the sole, what would that be? 20 feet?
It's not that high.
15?
So now you're flipping to map number C102?
Yep.
Okay, it's 9 feet elevation, you're saying, and then 9 feet on top of that for the guys that are close.
Okay, all right. Okay,
so what do we have for the closest location in the upper right to a resident?
Yeah, so that's the one that was about 400 feet. There is another residential street to the west side that's, mm-hmm. Beyond the limit of the landfill. And there's a wooded area there that sort of separates it.
So the closest resident is 400 feet from?
I think so. We didn't measure the ones to the west, but to me, that one appears to be the closest.
Okay, another question is, when you're putting in the posts, the fence posts will be 10 feet outside the cap, and you're going to be doing some initial borings just to see what the depth is so that you're not going to puncture the cap. So what happens if you do puncture the cap of the existing landfill?
Well, that's the purpose of the test pits. So what we do when we do the test pits is find evidence of landfill cap, and if there is no evidence of it, then we know we're beyond the limit of the cap.
Okay. But if you did puncture the cap, I mean, I'm not sure what material is on the cap.
It's either clay or a membrane. So landfills have either a low permeability soil cover, which is typically clay, or a geomembrane, which is a thick piece of plastic that goes over the top.
So if it was plastic and it was punctured, then you would just repair it?
It would have to be patched, yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
So the cap's organic material?
So the topsoil is organic. Yeah, okay. So there's a topsoil layer, there's a sand drainage layer, and then there's a low permeability cap layer.
Okay. And so there's soil above the cap. So is there a consistency in the depth of the soil above the cap?
No.
Okay.
I mean, by design, it probably was, but you know, during construction,
things. This is Lee Road, right?
Yeah.
That's the dump area, and see, we're over here.
Right. I think we're not ready for public comment yet.
Yeah, I think that. Let's see, we usually can see it. I think we're about here.
Is this Susan Parker? Susan, we're not quite ready for public comment, so could you please mute? And when we're ready for public comment, we welcome your comments.
Sorry.
No, that's okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right. Questions? Okay, I'm looking at there. You know, there are different things that you'll have to do before that. The health and safety plan, so that'll be sent to us, and that's before you get a permit to actually start. Okay. It also says the contractor will provide 24/7 active monitoring. 24/7.
Yeah. So NextAmp has a full. We call it the NextAmp Energy Center, and so where we have sort of a setup of monitoring all of our systems that we have in operation. So it is monitored 24/7. So if there's any sort of, you know, alarm or trip or anything, we'll know immediately.
Okay. So there's actually a person there at 3 a.m. Wow.
May I ask about security? There's the issue of problems with the panels and the battery, but I'm wondering about security. You said something about teenagers climbing fences, et cetera. Is there any special thing that's done about security of the site?
So it'll have a gate into the array. The fence is designed to, you know, allow the continued access on the road to the east to get to the back, but then there'll be a gate for the access road into the array itself with a lock. And typically we'll provide that information to the town so they can access it if need to, but otherwise it's just the town and NextAmp with that. And you know, we haven't had any issues with trespassers or anybody trying to get in. I think there's really not much to see or do.
Are there any known health risks to the surrounding residents to solar arrays that have been found?
No. Yeah.
Thank you.
I have a question, if I may. I can't see if other people were about to say something, though.
Go ahead, Emily.
My first question is, actually, I guess I have more than one, is did you say where the power is going? What is this supplying?
So the power will go back to the Eversource grid and be placed on the local grid here. So the actual power will just be going back to Eversource, and then the credits that are produced from the array. So this project will be part of the SMART program, which is the state incentive program that they've set up to support these projects. And so through that, we can set it up as a community solar project where the credits from the array can be sent to, you know, homeowners' bills, but the actual energy will just go back into the Eversource grid.
So the power staying local?
Yes, yep.
Okay. And then I guess more of a comment or two. The abutters are abutting a landfill right now, yes? Yeah. I just feel like maybe I would rather abut renewable energy than a landfill. And maybe that's my opinion. But I think that when we're thinking about land use and renewable energy, right now this is wasted space. And the thing with renewable energy is you have to want to see it if you believe in it. And I think we've stated in our master plan that we want to see more renewable energy and more sustainable initiatives. in town. And especially if the power is staying local, sometimes with large scale solar arrays like this, you see the power is being generated in a town like ours and then generated for like businesses and like server operations in like, I don't know, Arkansas. So it's great to see that this is going to stay local.
Okay. Thank you, Emily. Let's see. You have in there, let's see, an appendix I under stormwater. On page number 2, you've got minor tree clearing. Can you describe what you mean by minor tree clearing?
Yeah. So there should be a line on the plans. There are some areas where we have to clear the trees in order to do some of the drainage improvements that we're proposing out there. So, I mean, there's been a little bit of overgrowth on the landfill itself. So that's more or less what the tree clearing is. It's to clear the trees out around the extent of the array.
Okay. And do you know approximately how many trees?
I don't offhand.
Okay. We do have green bylaws and we're trying to keep our trees sort of important.
I mean, technically trees should not be on landfills.
Oh, so it is actually on the landfill.
In some instances, yeah, there's some overgrowth there. Okay. So, I mean, some of them are a bit off, but, you know, if sometimes things aren't mowed frequently or, you know, sometimes around the edges, the woods and trees tend to encroach a little bit, but.
If they're actually on the landfill cap, I can't imagine that their roots would be very deep if they're on the cap.
Well, already. I mean, roots can be an issue for landfill caps.
Right. Okay. As long as they haven't penetrated the cap.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
And so you'll know that as you're removing.
Well, I think for the trees, for the most part, we're just proposing to cut them and not necessarily stump and you know, grub them per se.
Okay. Yeah, I think it would be sort of nice to know approximately how many trees, you know, in what area that you'd be cutting them. Good to know.
There is a tree clearing line or a limit of work line. So if there's trees within that limit of work line, they would be cleared out to that limit of work. So those lines are shown on the plans.
Okay. No, you did supply us with many materials.
We try to be thorough.
Oh, yeah. Yep, that's how we spend our time. Okay. I think this is probably mostly, I mean, you talked about the construction period and you'll be monitoring that. And I mean, you said that if it's a quarter inch or greater, every single day we've had a quarter inch of greater rain these days. So I'm just curious, when would you plan on starting this? Hopefully not in the rainy season. We seem to have that.
Yeah. I think it depends on Eversource, right?
The monsoon.
Yeah, the continuous mud season.
Yeah.
Not just March anymore. We would hope to start as soon as we can.
Okay.
So Eversource, the last piece will be executing an agreement with Eversource, and we hope that'll be done by the end of this month.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, it's weather dependent, but if we could start construction this fall, that would be great.
Okay.
Again, it sort of depends on the weather. But speaking to the rain and stormwater stuff, I mean, so DEP, you know, requires inspections and ongoing sort of overseeing of the construction piece of it. So if there are any issues with rain or water, they can just, you know, shut things down and let things dry out before we proceed.
Okay.
And just to add to that, I'm working on two landfill projects in Massachusetts now that are under construction, and we've had a lot of shutdowns.
Yeah.
Today was a good example. But yeah, there's been a lot. It's been a rough spring and early summer.
Yeah, that's not the
But to Henry's point, yeah, DEP does require full-time oversight from a third party while there's construction vehicles on the cap. So footwork, things like that, sometimes they'll give exceptions for, but whenever there's equipment that could potentially have an impact on the cap, there'll be somebody there full-time.
Okay. So your project manager is from NextAmp and will be there all the time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
All right. So they're going to monitor, I mean, monitor the contractor and make sure that.
Okay. Yep.
All right.
May I ask, how long do you think the construction period would last, given no rain?
Yeah.
Given best possible.
Yeah. You know, typically this size, probably 3 months or so, is sort of the heaviest part of the construction. And then there'll be, you know, sort of ongoing doing, you know, wire maintenance and sort of management of the wires and hooking things up, which is kind of lighter lift. That can run another couple of months. So all told, you know, 3 to 5 months or so.
Okay. Yeah, just curious too. So, I mean, it seems like you've got it. I can't find where that is. I was just checking on liability. There's a lot of liability during, and it seems like you're covered.
Yep.
1 million for this, 2 million for that, 5 million for that. Okay. Workers'
yep.
comp, all of that. Okay.
Yeah.
Right. And liability after the build?
So we maintain full coverage okay. through the life of the project for that.
All right. And you continue to need to show us your proof of liability each year to make sure that you're.
We can definitely. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yep.
All right. Okay.
Question?
Kennelly? Okay. I guess we still have the, you know, the question of the trees. You know, we're sort of a little concerned about that. And, you know, if you can give us a better idea. Another thing is peer review.
Right.
Yeah.
So just to reiterate the information we sent you, we sent to Mass DEP as well, along with our supporting calculations for stormwater, geotechnical, things like that. So DEP is doing basically a technical review of these materials, just as a piece of information. So
okay.
When do you anticipate, this is Annalee Wolfcool, when do you anticipate those results as well as the interconnection agreement?
So the DEP, when I spoke to them, I think it was last week or week and a half ago, we were expecting to see something last week, hopefully this week, you know, with the holidays, sometimes things slow down, but they didn't have any major comments. And then, you know, Henry was saying he expects to hear back later this month from Eversource and on the interconnection.
Will the planning board have access to the report from DEP?
Yeah, we can certainly send it to you. It basically will be a letter. It's an approval. So what they do is summarize the project. You know, they note their decision and then they put conditions on it. So you'll see a lot of conditions that include some of the things that we've been talking about, like the requirement for third-party oversight, mm-hmm. monthly reports, and, you know, many other things that they'll add as conditions.
Okay. Let's see. So, okay. So, I mean, in other projects, so, I mean, that's a question. So this is my first rodeo with a landfill with solar, so I'm not really sure. So, I mean, have others that you work with, have they had a separate peer review aside from DEP?
Typically not. Yeah, not okay. for landfills. I mean, only because, you know, it'll sometimes be a local civil firm that does the review, but the stormwater strategy, the geotech strategy, everything is different on a landfill than it would be if it
right.
was. I mean, I would say for most greenfield sites, we see it the majority of the time, you know, especially from a stormwater standpoint, but typically not for landfills.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll just add that, you know, on a typical greenfield, DEP doesn't necessarily get involved. And so with a landfill, there's that DEP has that extra layer of sort of scrutiny, and they've seen so many of these across the state that they know what to look for and
right.
the issues that they've seen and how to address them okay. proactively.
All right.
That seems adequate to me. I just think that sounds adequate to me. I mean, to have another review seems a waste of resources and money.
Perhaps if you're anticipating it really momentarily, we're having another brief meeting next Monday and then another one after that.
Right,
so maybe we can make the decision about peer review after we see that.
Next month. Right. I mean, that, you know, that's something, I mean, typically, you know, with larger projects that we've worked on, we have required peer review just because we're not engineers. So I think it's always good to have another set of eyes. I'm sure the DEP will probably be fine. I just want to double check on that. Just, I think that would be really important. And the other thing is that we've also required on the other NextAMP project, we do require a bond. I notice on page, which section is this? Appendix F on page 32. I see it started, but there is no figure. There's no monetary figure for a bond.
For the decommissioning bond?
Yes.
Yeah. So that's because it's a town project. Through the initial RFP, there was the decommissioning agreement and a pilot agreement that we'll execute with the town.
Okay.
So that goes through you know, the town manager's office, something that will get done. And typically that's also a condition of getting a building permit, that
right
prior to getting a building permit, you have to have these two items in place.
Right.
So that's something that we're going to continue to work with the town on that, on getting those done.
Yeah, we will definitely need to see that. I think on the last large project we asked for a bond at something like 120%. So we'll have to review that as well.
Right. Okay. Yep.
All right. Okay. Let's see. What else? I don't know. I think I'm out of questions. I may be out of questions. I don't know. Yes. Well, yeah.
No. Yes, I'm looking at your application, and you talk about the decibels of the buzz, and it's a little bit hard for me to tell. You say 71 decibels at a distance of 10 meters. We understand that maybe the closest abutter is approximately 200 meters. But I don't know what 71 decibels sounds like. I mean,
so
a buzz if you're trying to sleep is a buzz. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. What's that?
Well, we've done some sound pressure calculations to further advance this a little bit. And I can certainly share these with you, but what we came up with is that the closest property line, the range is within 25 to say 43 decibels, and that's the equivalent of leaves rustling in the wind or average home noise. That gives you an idea of what, and this is at the property line.
At the property line of the closest to butter?
At the landfill property line. Yeah, I mean, it's a shared property line, right? Between the butter and
I see. But I think, weren't we saying earlier that there was like 400 feet between?
Right. We didn't advance it that far.
We
just did it to the property line.
So it's almost, I mean, as I look at that, let's say it's at least 300. It's 300 feet to the closest, maybe.
About 400.
Yeah. And you said that's trees rustling or?
This is at the property line. So at a distance of 41 feet, 42 feet, which is the closest to the property line, it's equivalent to leaves rustling in the wind or the average home noise.
And that'll be, you know, during the middle of the day when, because the noise is from the fan and the inverter to cool it. So during the day, that'll be going. But then at night, when, you know, the system shuts down, so there's really no noise at night at that point.
So it won't be like leaves rustling in the wind during a hurricane.
Right. So it's not continuous, it's intermittent. Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And I think, you know, with the background noise of the transfer station, and you've got 91 going right there as well, that's pretty loud.
Okay. Right.
So may I ask a question? This is Andrea. Where is a close example of this kind of an array on a landfill that's close to us?
I think there's one in Greenfield. I wasn't involved in it, but there's
Greenfield landfill.
Greenfield
AKA dump. Yeah. And that's been there for quite a while, hasn't it? Like it has. 10 years?
Yeah, 10 yep. years.
I think and Montague did one as well.
Okay. Yeah, I'm not familiar with that.
Montague.
And is this comparable to the size of Montague or Greenfield?
I don't know how big Greenfield is.
Yeah, I don't know either.
Montague, they actually have two separate sites. One is bigger and one is, I think, around this size. Same property, but two different landfills.
Okay. Wait, so the decibels are coming from the sound is coming from the...
So there's the inverter and then the fans, both on the inverter and on the storage system that, you know, help
okay.
cool it.
Okay. And is that a definite location? I mean, can it be farther away or not?
We could look into it. You know, I think the way why we designed it that way is to get it as close to the point of interconnection with Eversource as we can,
mm-hmm.
Just for a cost perspective and an efficiency, so that, you know, the further away we are with the inverter, the more losses we'll get from, you know, the inverter to where it's connected to the grid. So we try to build them as close as we can.
Mm-hmm.
We can certainly take a look if that's something. Well,
I mean, you know, since it is the rustling of the leaves, it would be great if it was not loud rustling of the leaves. And I mean, the farther away, the better.
But I mean, I think again, it's really during, you know, the heat of the day when it's going to be making that noise.
Okay.
So I'd anticipate, you know, just the overall ambient noise at that site to drown out anything from the inverter, just given, you know, the loaders and the traffic at the transfer station.
I mean, it's, I don't know, the traffic isn't that heavy, but
Kathy, this is Kathy Ochoa. The transfer station is only open 3 days a week too.
Yeah.
Tuesday, Thursdays, and Saturdays.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. No, we'll give you a chance to comment, just a few minutes. Okay. All right. So we're good with the abandonment. Okay. Existing vegetation. I think you answered that. Landscaping grading changes. Sounds good. I don't know. I don't have any more, Annalie.
Just if you could find out when you get your stormwater pollution prevention plan back, also that would be nice.
Right. Yeah.
Get it back.
Right, and that we know everything is in accordance with that with the EPA.
So yeah, we haven't prepared that yet. You know, we want to make sure we get all the other necessary approvals first. Usually, that the ENOI that's associated with that has to be submitted 2 weeks before construction. So it'll be weeks or months off, but certainly. You know, I think when we complete it, we can send you a copy of it.
Okay. Well, yeah, I mean, we'll need the building commissioner. We'll need that before mm-hmm. he furnishes a permit. Okay. Let's see. So I guess the only questions we have is, so you answered the one about the bond, and we're just going to find out about the peer review to see whether that is necessary. All right. And maybe check on decibels.
Excuse me?
And the trees. Yeah, you're going to check on the trees. Okay. All right. You know, another question. I had someone ask me, what's a return on investment for the town?
So there's the lease with the town. There's revenue coming in to the town for the 20-year period of the mm-hmm. lease and possible extensions over that.
Okay.
There's no real upfront cost to the town.
Right.
So it's really a return on, you know, leasing the land to Nexamp. So it's really a net benefit. You know, we will take care of the maintenance within the array, so there's less maintenance costs for the town. And also there's the opportunity. I think the town already has a contract for solar credits, but if there's additional appetite, you know, on the town side, they can receive credits from the array as well, kind of depending on your overall load and energy usage. Mm-hmm. and then the taxes as well. So there'll be an annual tax payment.
Right.
So it's really kind of four separate revenue buckets that, mm-hmm. that you could look at.
Say again, so tax payment is lease money. No upfront cost.
Right. Oh, the power purchase.
The ability potential to get credits from the array on your utility bills, taxes, and then just reduced maintenance cost for the landfill because we'll do the mowing within the, okay. the fenced area.
So you said potential for tax. I mean potential for energy credits.
Yep.
Can you? Elaborate on that.
So really just depends on given your existing contract, I don't know who is that with or how much of the town's bills it covers, but if there's still energy that the town uses that could be offset from this array, mm-hmm. we could send credits through the virtual net energy billing program with the state to send credits to whatever town accounts
okay.
could be offset, and then that would just reduce your overall energy cost on a monthly basis.
Okay, so that should be part of our agreement.
It depends on if you have additional capacity for credits,
mm-hmm.
And that's something that we can work with the town to look at your bills and usage and your current contract to see mm-hmm. how it might match up with what this array will produce.
Okay. No, that sounds great. Huh. Okay. All right. So if there are no other questions, I'm going to open up to public comment. So I'll give you a chance. I think Ms. Parker online, do you have a comment? Any public comment? Are you still there? Susan Parker? Andrew?
I'm trying to unmute her. I'm asking her to unmute, but she's not answering.
Okay. Well, until Susan is muted.
Unmuted. Yeah.
Right. Shoot.
Okay.
Excuse me. Yeah, do you want to come up here? No, you guys can start. Yeah, do you want to come up and... Yeah, you'll need to speak into the microphone, please, when you're talking. No, you need to speak into the microphone.
I'd like you to identify.
Yeah, or just hold it.
I live at 45 Lee Road, directly across from the landfill. And my name is Lloyd Glitter, and my wife, Lynn. And so, first of all, and invert it, right? Somebody has a question.
You really have to. Really can you sit down at the chair and speak directly into the microphone, okay. please? Yeah, right there. Thank okay. you.
Good. Somebody asked a question about inverters, about the technology. And so this is a new technology. This is really old technology. It's been around for, more than 40 years since it was on submarines. And we had inverters there
right.
on submarines. Inverters at the power plant I used to work at. And every inverter I ever came across, and what's the technology has dramatically changed. It makes a ding sound, and then you got cooling fans. So this is not a pleasant rustling of leaves that you're going to hear 24/7. And if you say that it's only going to happen during the day, you do not intend to use the batteries to go through the inverter to get power out at night, right?
Well, I think typically what we'll do is discharge the battery during the middle of the day, during the peak demand period.
But not at night.
Typically not at night, no.
Not typically, we'll not discharge the batteries at night.
I don't know exactly when.
There you go. See, I live right across from this, and I don't want to hear 24/7. Because mm-hmm. right now, anybody who lives on the road or close to it, the landfills only open up Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday. From 8:30 to 4.
Right.
And at it's dead silent.
Yeah.
So having worked at a power plant, you're going to hear this 24/7. Unless you do intend at 4 o'clock in the afternoon or whatever, shutting down the inverter. And it wouldn't make sense, would it, to have battery backups when you need power at night during a hot summer, you're going to use it. You're going to make that sound. So if I open up my windows, I live right on Lee Road, and they said 400 feet to my garage. Was that to my garage door? No. Where was that 400 feet?
It was the property to the east on the same side of the Lee Road. East is up.
To the top of the page, to the east. There's a residence there, to the east of the property line.
It's going to be there. Unless the technologies change, where the same whisper side, I don't believe that's possible. But you're saying 2.9 megawatts of power, decent amount of power. The inverters that had a power plant were in 2.9 megawatts. Nowhere near that, they were noisy. Okay. So here's a question. I'm not part of that one. You're thinking about it. And it says it's been done before in certain areas.
Sir, can I? I'm struggling. Yeah. Thank you.
You can mitigate part of this by putting up a sound deadened walls around us. It's one of the options to knock down that noise. Actually, knock it down virtually zero for me, and probably the other residents would be concerned because you open up the windows, you don't be sleeping at night hearing sounds of the inverters and the fans going. So that's one of my big issues right there with that. And another issue I have is the not for me, because I'm a senior citizen, but I can still drive a car and leave the area. Well, I have a neighbor that's 96 years old and can't leave the area. And we talked about a lithium battery fire. How big are these lithium batteries?
So they're about 9 feet high, 25 feet long. And
How many kilowatts, megawatts?
It's about 1.2 megawatts.
1.2 megawatts. Okay. The 1.2 megawatts, we're looking at close to like 12, to give you people an idea, we're looking at like 12 Tesla batteries roughly, that you have Tesla. And you heard about Tesla car fires, how intense the fire is. My question here is, okay, they say that, and I guess they talk to the fire chiefs and stuff, and they can let this thing burn to the ground. What about toxic fumes that come off of that? And if the prevailing wind direction's like where my neighbor is, right next to my house, 96 years old, how is she going to evacuate or leave?
Okay. All right. Thank you very much for your comments. All right. Yes, we've been limiting. Could you have another question?
No, I think that's it. That's my two big concerns. Thank you.
Would you mind just signing into the paper there? Sign your name into the paper. Whoops. There the, behind,
I'm sorry,
you.
The pen just fell. If you could, please sign your name. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. Amy, were you able to unmute Ms. Parker's?
I have been asking her to unmute. That seems to be the best I can do. And I am not getting anywhere.
So. Well, did you mute her before, or did she mute her?
I muted her, but Lordy.
Oh. That's your husband. Okay.
I said the only thing I have here is ask to unmute, and I am asking, and it doesn't seem to be doing anything. If she wants to make a comment, I think maybe she could try commenting on.
You can't unmute her yourself. She has to do personal.
Can't.
Okay.
Asked to unmute. It's just not getting me anywhere.
I mean, is it possible she stepped away?
I don't know.
Well, at this point, yes. Well, if you keep trying, that's great. unfortunately, she's muted. Okay, at this point, I don't see any other questions. We do have, you know, some outstanding information that we'd like to get, and one is about the trees. Decibels, that is still a little bit of a question, and I'm not sure. I mean, I'm actually surprised from 300 abutters that there aren't more people here asking questions. Well, I think at this point, do I have a motion to continue?
Yes. I move, because we have two meetings in the next 3 weeks, something like that. I mean, we have one next week, and then we have one again after that. Yeah, that's what I think. I think I would move, and I would ask that you would sign on for to continue this. You're welcome to join us by Zoom on another date, next Monday, for example.
Which one is it? No, not the 17th. That's just for 179.
That's only for 179? We can't do any business?
No, that's not the Leary line. No, that's just on Zoom. We can't.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, then it has to be August.
Yeah. What, do you know what the date is? The August. Yeah. Is it August 3rd? August 7th?
That's our next meeting.
Yep.
That's what I'm continue the hearing.
And by that time, you'll have the information from DEP.
And from the select board.
And from the select board relative to the things that they need to bring to the table relative to, for instance, but the decommissioning, like that, if they're the actual agents for decommissioning, we still need to know what their plan is. We can't, we're the ones that are on the hook for that decommissioning. So if they have a plan for it, we want to know about it without them here telling us that. Yeah. We can't just take it on.
No,
they're, you know, this isn't going to work for them. So that alone, I'm feel like we need a select board, either presence or a note in our packet from select board saying we're all squared away on that. And that, you know, an O&M is obviously not a big deal for a solar, you know, but where the reporting is, we need all that kind of stuff, and to whom it comes to us. In the past, I'm just imagining that because the town is the leaser, like that just adds a layer that we're not ready for to deal with, I think, tonight quite. So that's why I'm moving to continue this to our August meeting.
Can I ask a question? For things that we haven't prepared yet, like the O&M plan, health and safety plan, can those things be a condition of approval that we provide those prior to getting the building permit?
Yes. Yeah, okay. They would be. Yep.
Is
this the SWIP plan, the SWIP, and then the, yeah.
Just to clarify on the O&M plan, I think we did provide a general O&M plan in the application. Is there something more specific that you're looking for?
I feel like the information that you've given us today, the round the clock, you know, like that you have somebody there on site, that, you know, we have, there's a person to talk to should that, you know, noises become different than what we expected, that kind of thing. I would also, you know, I think each of us needs to get out there and just drive around and see the area a little bit more. I just did that this morning so that we're familiar with the butters situations relative to the layout of the land.
Yeah.
I mean, I actually don't use the landfill, so I don't usually go there. So for a lot of people, it's pretty familiar territory, but for me, it's not.
Okay.
Excuse me?
Annalee Wolfkuhl, can we as a planning board have a site visit?
Yeah.
You know, planned?
I think that would be great. Would someone want to?
Yeah,
I mean, that sounds pretty exciting.
We had it on the, just as a point of order, and we did have a concern about sound for the Keats Road. So if anybody wants to head up there too and hear that, the Keats Road is a big trans inverter, makes a noise. There were concerns. We were actually not talking about leaves at that point, but like lawnmowers. So, you know, I mean, what it's relative to and the change in technology, that was a long time ago. It may be a softer engine now, but I think that kind of thing is good for us to also keep looking into, because it was a big concern for that. Right. That project as well on Keats Road.
Right. And, you know, I guess another thing is that, you know, although there are 300 abutters, which I find amazing that there's so many, what's the percentage of the abutters that are so close that could be affected by this? And probably, you know, the ones right on Lee Road, I don't know the other abutters. I mean, I'm assuming all the condos, but that's farther away. Right.
But there are.
Well, not that far, but.
Site visit.
Yeah. So I think a site visit would be great. Okay, so if we want to, can we set that up now? While we're all here, that would make sense. Okay.
Rain or shine?
Yes.
Hopefully not rain.
We have boots. We've done worse.
Yeah, we've got boots.
Okay, cool.
All right. Well, I'm away until Sunday. Next week, I mean, I don't know what everyone's schedule is. What's your schedule?
We'll make it work. Whatever's good for you all.
What time is day?
Sunday.
Monday.
Fridays, basically.
Friday.
After
Monday. No, you can't do Monday.
What? Okay, what day doesn't work?
We have Tuesday. I can do Tuesday.
What time?
Oh, you can't do Monday or Tuesday.
Well. It may not work for everybody.
Right.
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 Wednesday?
Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday.
Wednesday.
How does Wednesday the 19th sound?
After 3?
Whenever. I mean, if I can't make it.
Or in the morning? Which one?
I can do Wednesday morning.
Wednesday morning?
I can also do Wednesday at like 4. No problem.
No, that's fine. Wednesday afternoon.
No.
Yeah, I can do Wednesday afternoon.
Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, I'm open. So whatever works for you guys, if I can make it.
So 3:30?
Wednesday, 3:30?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's good for everyone. And that is.
Dump's not open.
Excuse me?
Right.
The transfer station's not open.
We'll get a key. We'll get a key.
You're having.
Okay. So we're talking.
Yep.
Wednesday, the 19th. July 19th at 3:30. And before you leave, it would be great to get your phone number.
Sure. Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Just in exchange.
Do you want me to write it?
Yeah, that would be great.
Okay.
I can probably make that. I might be like 10 minutes late.
Okay. All right. So we're going to do that. And Amy, we'll have to put that as a meeting.
Right.
Okay.
Yep, I have that down. Wednesday, July 19th, 3:30 p.m. I will make sure to post that properly so that it is a meeting.
Okay. All right, great.
Thank you.
So we'll be able to answer some of these questions, see what's happening. Anything else? Okay, so Rachel, you did have a motion.
I did. I moved.
Okay. Do I hear a second
to
Rachel's motion to
I
continue the public
Kathy.
Hearing to August 7th?
Kathy, just
I seconded.
Okay. Kathy Latrobe seconded that.
Kathy Latrobe, yes.
Okay. Andrea Leibson,
yes. Yes. Andrea Leibson, yes.
Annalee Wolfwell, yes. Kathy Sylvester, yes.
Rachel Blaine.
Rachel Blaine, yes.
Denise Mason, yes. Okay, so we're going to continue the public hearing to
Emily.
Sorry, Emily.
Yes. Emily Gaylord, yes, it's okay. Is my face not big enough for you?
Okay, so that's August 7th. Is that 7th? At 6 p.m.
6:30?
Yeah. 6:30, sorry. I'm getting my meetings mixed up.
And Denise, if we can make sure to have them sign the continuation form since they're there. I left you a continuation form.
Yeah, I've got a continuation form.
Yeah, so if we could just have the representatives sign that. It says applicant signature.
Okay. Requested by the applicant. So I have someone. Okay.
So we can have someone from the team who's here to just sign that as a representative for the applicant.
Okay.
And then I will have that stamped in.
So which part of the team wants to sign this?
Happy to.
Go to. Okay. All right. That would be great. If you could sign right there under applicant and date that. We'll be good to go. Excellent. Thank you. Okay. And you put your phone number down, so we're good.
Yeah. And I've been in contact with the town manager as right. well. So people, I think, have our contact yeah. info. But okay. I guess we'll just reach out just to confirm sure. you know, early next week.
Yep.
Logistics and keys and everything.
Again, we'll do it rain or shine.
Yeah.
We'll
yeah.
just have umbrellas and boots.
Right. Okay. Sounds good. Yeah.
The drill.
Yeah. And, you can send that through me. I'm the administrative assistant. I'm at building assist at town of Deerfield. I'm not sure if you have that address, that email address.
Oh, the email, your email address?
Yeah. I'm sorry. I don't remember the applicant's name because I don't hear very, but yeah, if you guys just want to send that stuff directly to me, the
we have the email.
You have her. Yeah.
Okay, great. Okay. Thanks.
All right, great. So the public hearing is continued, so we will be able to continue public comment at that time.
Thank you for that.
So if there's any new information, any new comments from the public, we will welcome. All right. So I think we're finished until then. Thank you so okay. much for coming.
Thank you. Great. Thank you very much. And, appreciate it.
We'll see you next week.
All right.
Okay.
Sounds good.
Great. Thanks.
Thanks.
Okay. Let's see. Where are we? Okay. Let's see. Is there any other business not reasonably anticipated 48 hours before the meeting that we know of? No. Okay. Let's see. Do we have any reports from committees? Oh, yeah. That would have been nice to have that. Yeah, right.
Open Space Committee is meeting next week at the end of May. Several of us on the committee met with a representative from Eagle Brook School to discuss access to Rice's Ferry Road and issues around creating a public park, essentially a walking trail. From that area. So we continue to talk to the public and work on things around open space.
Great. I'm trying to think. Annalie, do you have anything from senior housing?
Senior housing is working to explore different sites for potential senior housing to be built. And we certainly are being constrained by wetlands from Bloody Brook and also the buffer zone, but maybe not constrained, just that's challenged. Yes, thank you. So if people could, I think some of those discussions are posted certainly on the Deerfield website for under senior housing, as well as the CCI meetings. If people want to have more specific input right now, it still is very much a work in progress and really looking potentially at three different sites.
Are you Thanks. Saying that site isn't going to work that we have? I mean, we don't know that.
We are not sure what site it might be, but we're still looking at the whole campus area. And there's also a question of purchasing some additional property, but the assessment is being done on that property. And, you know, if the gods of the former church are with us, then we will be affordable, but right. they might have been retired.
I don't know.
Which, so, if you don't mind me asking, sorry.
Do Kathy, you have a developer? Like, is there somebody who's then already ready and willing to? No. Okay. That, because that seems to me that's what I can't figure out in Sunderland. Who is that developer?
Yeah.
That is a nifty little project. Mm-hmm. And I drive in there and I think, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Let's build one of these. But I don't do that. Somebody else does that.
Yeah.
We're certainly, we've visited that site and have been in both, I think, select board people as well as CCI. And I mean, we're in conversation.
Yeah.
But no, we're still just sort of at the preliminary stages of where might this go. And also too, I mean, it, which is very good, is that senior housing is trying to look at that in the context of a larger campus.
Right.
And where would the
walkable. I mean, that's the great thing about that site, is it's walkable to so many things. And I think
the ball field and all of that. And what's happening with the police station and the wetlands and the
Got it.
Okay. All right. Yeah, just a little bit on CCI. We do have funding. Fortunately, we don't have to report on grants, but it's through Complete Neighborhoods. And so we have VHB, and they've been very responsive, very good. They are working with us, with CCI, to come up with some different scenarios. And it's really just in the beginning stages. I think we have them online on where we're working with senior housing on that, because that's really the springboard for getting the Complete Neighborhoods grant, is to figure out where can we put senior housing within the campus. So we're working with them. They've come up with different scenarios. Nothing is set in stone. Some of them probably won't work. They got some good feedback from us at our last meeting, and I encourage anybody who was not at that last meeting who wants to look at the video. And we did send slides out. So to take them, I think I have another conversation with them, and then we will have a public meeting. They'll do another presentation. I believe it's September 14th right now. So they will be, asking for other comment from, from townspeople. So, but, they've been really great to work with, and it's nice because the information they get, they're sharing with Berkshire Design and sort of vice versa. So I think it's pretty much a collective effort, which has been really nice. I did hear from, as far as the 1888 building, which is the former grammar school, former senior center, we did put in funding, and, Tim Hilch was really instrumental in doing that, to Joe Comerford, Natalie, to who else? To Senator Warren, I forget. But I think Markey did say that he's got three different projects for Massachusetts. Ours is one of them, for $4 million earmark, and said that it's not a real controversial, it's not a real political thing. So he's hopeful. So, but we won't find that out until probably towards the end of the calendar year. So that's happening. So there's a lot going on with CCI, and anybody's welcome to join the meeting or look at the website. It's deerfieldcci.org. So, all right. Any other comments? Any other reports?
We haven't met.
No, okay. Was there any mail? Not anything to speak of. Okay. All right.
I move that we adjourn.
I second.
Oh, look at, we're a 1-2 dynamo down here.
All right. Kathy Wetroba?
Kathy Wetroba, aye.
Andrea Leibson?
Aye.
Emily Wolf-Cole, aye.
Kathy Sylvester?
Kathy Sylvester, aye.
Rachel Blaine, aye.
Denise Mason, aye.
Wait. What?
Again. So me. Okay, Emily Gaylord, aye. I'm just kidding. You know that.
Thank you, Emily. We didn't mean to leave you out. Okay, meeting adjourned.
Bye, everyone. Nice to see you from up here.
Oh, my God, I'm so tired.